I was known to trash talk. You know, that's one of my best assets because 9 out of 10 times, a guy ain't gonna fight in the game. Okay, they don't want to fight. But all y'all that watch NBA games, half of them guys do it for TV. They wouldn't throw a punch, wouldn't bust a grape in a fruit fight. Okay, so do not think they want to fight. It's all for TV. So I knew that at times, and you know what I'm saying, I really pushed the envelope because I knew I was ready to go, but I knew they wasn't. So sometimes that got me 8 to 10 points just punking a motherfucker. You know what I'm saying?
We used to punk motherfuckers that we believed to.
That's a part of the game.
We punked Dallas.
If we see that you're scared, we're gonna take advantage of it, right?
Blood in the water.
I used to do that to a lot of people, and I was always talking shit. I even won the Trash Talk Award, the Big Three, which was nothing, but. I remember, you know, playing against Kobe, man. Kobe used to talk trash, but it's hard to kind of go back and forth with him, not only because he shoot a lot, but he making the motherfuckers.
He's a bad motherfucker.
And you don't get that many attempts.
No, not even close.
So I finally got a post up on him. You know what I mean? I got the ball on the post. I'm backing him down. You know, I'm looking at him like, I'm a little nigga. And I'm finna, you know, that's how I'm looking at him. Hit him with the shoulder. I turn around and shoot it. He just, wow, whole arm off, right? The referee, I'm on the baseline. The referee right there. So I turn and look at the referee. Kobe takes off with the ball. I'm like, what the fuck? So I'm talking to the referee, arguing with him. And as I'm talking to the ref, Kobe is saying something to me. Like, you better pay attention. Like, you know what I'm saying? Fuck all that. Because I start saying something to Kobe, too, about hacking ass. You know what I'm saying? So as I'm talking to the referee, Kobe shoots like 10 feet from the three-point line. Net. And gives me a little smirk. Like, look at me. And then the referee look at me like, he on Kobe's side, you know what I'm saying? Kobe just run down the court, just talking to me like I'm a kid, and next thing you know, Pop just subbed me out the game. So I'm on the sideline looking like I was just a bump, you know what I mean? Like Kobe, one thing about Kobe, he gonna talk to you, and he gonna get every shot. And you're not gonna get the same amount of attempts as him.
Close.
You know what I mean?
Not even close.
People don't know, Kobe talk a lot of trash, bro.
Yeah.
It might not be curse words, it might be nothing like that, but it's just what he gonna do to you. And he'll tell you before he do it.
And he'll still do it.
He'll still do it.
You can do to stop it. I mean, my shit too was, our shit was a little bit of back and forth talking that situation in Orlando with the ball fake, but it was more the grabbing, the elbowing. I caught a tip dunk that he tried to block Dwight's shot and he left me open and I went and tip dunked and I was coming off the rim and motherfucker tried to elbow me on my nuts. So it just came to a point, like you said, where he fouled you right in front of the refs and the refs act like they motherfucking Ray Charles at the time. Like, bitch, you know you motherfucking saw that.
Exactly.
Right? So it came to a point in Orlando where he was doing all this dirty shit and I would get caught retaliating. So I got a couple fouls. I got one T. But it's bullshit, like you said, because you got to do everything you can to stop him, knowing goddamn well. I know in my situation, he took like 30 shots that game. You know what I mean? Like, it takes me six games to get 30 shots. You know what I mean? So it was tough, but battling him is always fun. But I used to tell people guarding him, he tries to mentally fuck you too, because physically, you know, there's nothing much you could do with him. But he tries to get that mental battle too, whether it's talking shit, elbowing you, grabbing you, you know, the pump faking you 18 times, and then you jump and he barely slides against you and the ref calls a foul. So it was a motherfucking battle, just like I said, but that was my favorite. Whenever I played, I was just like, hell yeah, I get to play Kobe tonight. You know what I mean? And my whole thing is, you're not going to start great offense with good defense regardless. You just want to make them work for everything.
Make it difficult on them.
Make them work. You know, no easy layups. You go to the basket, I'm going to foul the shit. I'm not giving you no easy layups. I'm going to make you work for everything. And if you even are having 30 points, I want you to take 30 shots.
You remember when Golden State, when me and him was going back to back in threes?
Uh-huh. Yeah,
we
was going at
winning
it.
The game.
We beat him.
He was talking to him. He was looking like, man, come on. I'm talking about he was hitting some crazy shots at the end of that game.
Sick.
Dog.
So you briefly touched on it. I mean, amongst that shit talking and back and forth between you and Kobe, you guys ended their streak for 4 in a row in San Antonio. That's when you got your first ring.
Yeah, I mean, they was a dominant team. Nobody wanted to play the Lakers. They had been dominant over the Spurs. Definitely. Tim and Dave couldn't get over that hump. I know they won that bullshit championship in 99, the Spurs did. But,
with the shortened season.
Yeah, that shortened season. But the Lakers, they couldn't get past the Lakers. Mm-hmm. That year, it was basically guaranteed that they was going to win again. We had kind of struggled with them during the regular season because Kobe and Shaq were just a little bit too much. But I think Tim had it in his mind.
No matter what.
No matter who was on the court, I'm finna be the best player from game one. I think the first game he had like a 20-20. Like that was his standard the whole series. And he made it a point to guard Shaq to the point where he was playing so well, Kevin Willis was coming off the bench getting tip dunks and, you know, blocking Shaq's shot. You know, so I think just having Tim Duncan and where his mind was, that was the only reason we was able to stop their four-peat. You know, and to see Kobe and Shaq and them over there crying and, you know, Derek Fisher and them over there crying, it was a good feeling, bro, because that was my first year that I actually felt like I was in the league. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like I belonged. Dope. And I had, and you know, being on a chance to win a championship, that was special to stop them too.
That's what's up. But you know, it was crazy for me because I'd always battled Kobe. You know, even dating back to when he first came to LA, he used to come up to UCLA and play and
you got
and
a chance
work
to play
out
with him, though.
You know what I mean? But then to be able to, you know, have someone that I looked up to so much and loved competing against, competing with, it was amazing. And my first year there was we were going for their second three-peat. But I ended up tearing my meniscus, I want to say in February, I think that year. And that's the year that we got swept by Dallas. And I think Dallas beat Miami in the finals. But like I said, getting a chance to play with him and seeing his day in, day out preparation, how hard he worked on his game, getting up in the morning and hitting the track and the weights. And I mean, like, it's still dark outside type shit. Like, he was just, I say, like an evil genius. You know what I mean? Like a beautiful mind. Like, he was so obsessed with being the best. But he put the work in, too. So it was just amazing to be able to, you know, say that I battled, to me, against the second greatest player of all time. And then I was actually a teammate with him for a little while too. That shit was dope, man. Like I said, I learned a lot. He wasn't someone who was a very, like, a vocal, he was the leader, but he wasn't one of those yelling all the time vocal leader. It was a situation when he spoke, you listened, and then he would just give you that motherfucking look. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Or that, I mean, you know, you got to pass to him when he gives you his little Mamba hiss, mm-hmm. like, you know, he's open. But it was just, you know, lead by example. If your best player is going to go out there every single night and leave it all out there, there's no excuse for no one else not to.
I didn't get a chance to play with him, but I got a chance to play with him in the McDonald's All-American game in 96.
Early on.
And just his presence was like it is now.
It's a different energy.
When he walked in practice as a 17, 18-year-old, when he walked in practice, we all felt it. Like he was the next thing, the next mm-hmm. big thing, you know? And he was that good, but it was just, I was excited to be on his team in the McDonald's game because I knew how, you know, the ceiling they had for him. And shit, he reached all those expectations.
Mm-hmm. Hell of a run, man.